Okay, so I am clearly still getting over this horrible cold. It's just like this roller coaster cold where one day it's fever and chills, and another couple of days it's coughing and hacking to the point where, you know, my ribs hurt so much I don't want to do one more cough. And right now I think I might just start to turn the corner on this thing. So I thought, okay, I'm gonna jump right in there and do a vlog. And it's a bit of an interesting subject. I was reminded of this by a poster I saw recently for the film Breaker Morant, circa 1979 or so. Now, this was my dad's favorite film, and we had it on RCA video disc. It was like a record, you know, a big encased record in this plastic thing, and you put it in the player. And when I was a kid, it was pretty long and uninteresting and boring to watch. But I've since, you know, greatly appreciated the film and became interested in more. So there is a book that inspired the film, written by one of the three principals that the movie depicts. The book is called Scapegoats of the Empire, and it's public domain now. It's 100 years old. So, you know, Gutenberg or many books, I would highly suggest you check it out. Now, you'd have to have some familiarity with the story in order to get interest. So I'll just do a very brief. The Bushveld Carbineers were an Australian regiment sent in to help with the Boer War in Africa. And the Australians comprised the minority of troops that were there, this large English contingent, and Australia, being a subject of the Empire, had some regiments there. The Carbineers were mounted riflemen, and field conduct was the question of the story, and what a government condones in times of war. The standing orders that Brigham Morant and the Bushveld Carbineers had were muddled, it seems purposely, so that at one point the commander of the unit, Commander Hunt, I believe, was captured by the Boers, tortured and killed. And Morant said that the last thing Hunt told him was to go and get the Boers, you know, not to take prisoners. And this was actually confirmed by a lord. I'm trying to think of the lord's name right now. It's not coming to me. So Morant's unit went out, and although some attempts were made to take prisoners in the scope of war, there was no feasible way they could manage prisoners out on the veldt, you know, fighting the Boer. And they didn't take prisoners a lot of the time. And it was the way both sides acted. Now, what got me thinking about the story again, these men were put on trial, by the way. During the trial of Morant and two other officers, the English lord initially declined to speak on whether or not any verbal okay was given, and then later on he flat out denied giving it, which essentially sealed their doom. The war was over. They needed someone to blame, so they executed Morant and these three others for improper field conduct, or whatever they wanted to call it, because they killed the enemy. So I'm always, you know, ever since I was a kid and I saw the story, I thought it was pretty crystal clear. But recently I saw a poster, an advertisement for the movie that I hadn't seen before. It was probably a newly made advertisement for the DVD copy or whatever. But it said, Breaker Morant, hero or villain? And it just made me stop, you know. All the times I've seen the story, I've thought, you know, man, these guys got screwed over by the military and the government. You know, they were summarily court-martialed and killed. And they had one guy who put up a very good defense for them, but he was just essentially shouted down and ignored. So, hero or villain? And I'm thinking, well, how exactly would he be a villain? So I'm reviewing some details of the story. There was an incident with a missionary, a Dutch missionary, where in a covered wagon, I believe it was known the missionary would smuggle arms and supplies in his covered wagon. And so eventually, after doing this, you know, he was found dead. And it was logically assumed that one of the men had enough of the missionary smuggling stuff, but when he was found dead, obviously there was no smuggled supplies in his wagon. So I think that was one of the points. And of course, the killing of prisoners is another. If you're out a small contingent camping in the wilderness and you don't have the means to, you know, adequately take care of yourselves, much less prisoners, it's a very tricky situation. This isn't any kind of modern warfare that we're talking about. We're talking about horses and short shotguns. So how would he be a villain, this guy who wrote poetry and wanted to avenge the death of Captain Hunt, who was tortured and killed. So the missionary point is one of them, the prisoner point is another, and the government denying, okaying it, you know, a verbal okay, later denied, sealing the fate. And I never really looked at the possibility that here's this guy who could be a villain in the story, because I had always seen it as not not a hero either, but a guy who just tried to do his job and acted with his feelings within reason a lot of the time, and got screwed over and was just made into a scapegoat, along with his two other officers. And the third guy, by the way, was the one who wrote the book. He was slated for execution, but he was eventually spared, and the other two were killed. And this guy, George, was it Wheaton? I mean, I've just got to think. I think George Wheaton is another guy, sorry. He went on and wrote Scapegoats of the Empire. And my cold is kicking in again, and I really wanted to be prepared with a lot of, you know, factual stuff that I could reference, but I just turned on the camera and I started. So maybe this will start a discussion or not, but wanted to check in and do a vlog.